super lawyers is going to be my brother-in-law, Lou Paper. Lou chairs the communications group at Dickstein Shapiro, and in the past he served as associate general counsel of the FCC, worked on the Hill, legislative counsel to Senator Gaylord Nelson. He's an academic at heart. He's an adjunct professor at Georgetown University Law Center. And something that's very, very impressive, he's written five books. He's written a book on Brandeis, on Kennedy, on Bill Paley. And he's very, very bright. And we'll see how a very bright lawyer can telescope doing the deal, the highlights, and the FCC process in 7 minutes. Lou?
Well, that's quite an introduction. I don't know if I can do it in 7 minutes, and maybe I should pass and go to the back of the room now. I think I want to pick up on Diane's last point about being able to walk away from a deal, because that is part of the process of negotiating a contract. And then if you are able to execute a contract, then we can talk just briefly about the FCC process. But I guess I should start by saying I'm reminded about something Lyndon Johnson said many years ago, which is that if two people agree on everything, you can be sure only one of them is doing any thinking. As a general proposition, you do not have to worry about that when you're negotiating a contract, because there will be a lot of thinking, presumably on your part, and I can guarantee you that there will be a lot of thinking going on the seller's part. And I think you will find that it can be a nice and friendly relationship on the one hand, but it is an adversarial relationship. And this agreement is a part of the process, because you have to go into the contract negotiation process remembering that the two of you are coming from different perspectives. The seller is interested, basically, in getting as much money as quickly as he can with as little fuss as he can. And the buyer is interested in obviously paying as little as the buyer, he or she, can afford or wants to pay, but also making sure that you're protected for the future. The seller is not concerned about the future. He's only concerned about the closing date and getting that money. And you as the buyer will have to worry about what happens after you pay the money to get the station. Now, the process generally starts off with a letter of intent. Not always, but usually you have what's called a non-binding letter of intent, meaning it's not a legally binding document. It just sets forth the basic parameters of the deal that you hope to make. When you get to that point of doing a letter of intent, you will have done some preliminary due diligence, because you will have had to make a decision, at least a preliminary decision, that this is a station that you would like to buy. And you will have to have done a sufficient amount of due diligence to know whether how much you are willing to pay for the station, and also whether you have access to the resources, debt and equity, to buy the station, because one of the key parameters of a letter of intent will, of course, be the purchase price and how it's going to be paid. Somebody else here is going to talk about that due diligence process. But you will sign a letter of intent, presumably, that will set forth the terms, basic terms of the deal that you hope to come to. And it will give you a certain amount of time, usually 30 days, 45 days, in which you will continue to do your due diligence on the station, and the parties will prepare the contract. In terms of preparing the contract, obviously, as Diane says, it's good to get a good lawyer. And I think in picking a lawyer, I would say this, that people generally don't like blind dates. And it's good to find a lawyer who's recommended by somebody, somebody you feel comfortable with, because you're going to be spending a lot of time together. And so therefore, it's important to feel very comfortable. The person not only needs good credentials, there has to be some, as I say, chemistry, so you will feel comfortable talking to this person. The lawyer's role, I would say this, that most contracts, usually it's a purchase of assets, so it's an asset purchase agreement. On occasion, it might be a stock purchase agreement or a membership purchase agreement, and that's often driven by the seller. Sometimes the seller doesn't want to sell assets. The seller wants to sell the ownership interests of the company, which could be stock or membership interests. And that's something that will be dealt with at the beginning when you're doing the non-binding letter of intent. But when you are doing this, the key thing that the lawyer really basically at this point in preparing the contract is, and I don't mean to denigrate the insurance industry, but it's really like an insurance salesperson, because the lawyer's construct of the contract is designed to protect you from risks that are known and also to some extent risks that are unknown. And as I was saying, to a large extent, purchase agreements, asset purchase agreements or membership or stock purchase agreements, you would find that there's a great similarity among the various documents used, agreements used by the law firms. But it's in the little details where the lawyer can become important and serve his role as your insurance broker. Because as Diane indicated, you have to worry about what happens after you close and what happens if you discover a problem after you close. Will the contract protect you? And, well, I shouldn't even say after you close. You also, as a starting point, want to know what are the closing conditions? Are there certain things that have to be done in order to satisfy you that you want to do this deal? Sometimes, and the circumstances that can arise are myriad, and there's no way to give a catalog of them. But, for example, does a renewal application have to be granted, which is usually the case before you'll get an assignment granted? Does the station have to relocate to a different antenna? Does the station have to build out some upgrade that you are depending upon? There are various circumstances. You will also want to, for example, look at the leases. Does a lease have to be renewed? There's all circumstances for closing conditions that you will want to make sure are addressed, as I say, so that when you buy the station, you are buying what you think you are buying, and you will have the assets, and the assets will be what you think they should be, and enable you to operate the station. Now, another key parameter, obviously, is a purchase price. A lawyer generally doesn't get involved in the purchase price. Usually, that's something that you work out with your people who are providing you with money, either debt or equity or both, because there's a limit as to how much you can or should pay, because you want to keep in mind that the economy changes. And for example, I would say that people who bought stations in 2005 or 2006 on the assumption that the economy was in robust and that station values would continue to appreciate, I would say a good percentage, maybe a majority of those people who bought stations with financing in 2005 and 2006, many if not most of them, all the equity was wiped out. And so because the economy took a downturn that no one anticipated. And so again, a lawyer can help you think through some of the parameters of the contract when you're buying the station, so that you can at least limit. There's no way to eliminate every risk. I mean, there's no contract that can do that, but you can at least minimize the risk. One thing you can do, for example, in a contract, though, to protect you against risk is indemnification clauses. You have to worry about what happens if you do buy the station and you subsequently find out that the assets are not what you thought they would be, and the representations or warranties that the seller made to you are not valid or not correct, and you want to make a claim. You have to make sure that the indemnification provisions are sufficient, and more than that, you want to make sure that the seller is going to be around and that there are adequate resources to cover indemnification. What happens many times is that when these sellers are getting out, they're happy to get out, they're liquidating their investment, and they're going to want to get rid of their company and move on. And so if you have something goes wrong after the closing and you want to pursue a claim against the seller, you want to make sure the seller is still there and that the seller still has resources to cover any indemnification claim for any breach of a representation and warranty. Sometimes to handle that, you might insist, for example, on having a post-closing escrow agreement where a certain percentage of the purchase price is placed into an escrow account for a certain period of time to cover any claims that might be made after the closing. So you will go through this process, and like I say, there will be a lot of disagreements and a lot of pushing back and forth between the attorneys and the parties. And I would say, to pick up again on Diane's point, you have to persevere, and you have to be single-minded, and you cannot be intimidated or afraid of confrontation. Not to say it's nasty, but people will disagree, and you have to know what it is you can do or are willing to do, and be willing to stick to your position, and be willing to support your lawyer in negotiating the terms so that you don't try and be too friendly and too accommodating in giving the seller what the seller wants, and in the course of doing that, sacrifice protections that your lawyer would like to provide for you. So I would say you can find an experienced attorney who can explain to you the risks, and you just have to be either willing to know what the limit of risks are that you're willing to take, and if you can't provide the kind of comfort you need for the future, then like Diane says, you have to be willing to walk away from a deal. And it's no different than in negotiating if you're buying a car. I'm sure many of you have had the experience where you walk into a car showroom and the salesman says to you, I've got this deal and it's only for today, and if you don't sign the paper today, this deal is going to go away. And you say, this is not the deal I want, and you walk out the door. And I would say most of the time the salesman's on the phone to you the next day saying, well, I've talked to my manager, and for you, we're going to extend this deal one more time, and he's offered to lower the price by this much. And it's the same thing with negotiating the terms of a agreement to buy a radio station. If you stick to your guns as to what you think is appropriate, you will find that there is some give and take in the negotiation process. And so if you are fortunate enough to sign an agreement for a station that you can afford that protects you against these risks, at least that you can identify, then of course you have to file an application with the FCC. You cannot acquire a station, I'm sure you all know this, without getting the approval of the FCC.